Please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the Lord be with you. It's appropriate and has been our longtime tradition to begin all our gatherings in prayer with words of welcome. And therefore, we begin with our blessing of welcome to each and every one of you, in a special way, perhaps to those who are visiting us, maybe for the first time. And also to bless into our presence those among us who are non-Catholics. Thank you for teaching us that God is greater than any one church. God speaks many languages. And God is revealed in diverse ways. And when we come together as one people, one family, one community, diverse yet united, where we emphasize unity, not uniformity. Different lifestyle, different life choice, different belief, life practice, but one people united in faith and in belonging, and we bless you as God's people. In a special way to call by name Anne and Peter and Anna, Tommy and Selena, Beth and Gary, Katie and Eric, Megan and Hans, and Phil and Claire, Joyce and Marilyn, and also to bless into our presence Madeline and Charlie and Ben, Catano, Tommaso, Ronaldo, Felix, Grace, Maggie, Ollie, Ferris, and Ayman. And in a special way to welcome my good brother, my Jesuit brother here. Jesuits always welcome at Holy Family. They infuse us with a certain Ignatian tradition which elevates us. All these Jesuits are far more educated than the rest of us. So we're very happy to welcome Father Tom O'Neill, who is a family friend for many, many years and a member of the faculty at Loyola High School. In the waters of baptism, Dick died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May he now share with him eternal glory. And we bless his body with the holy water, which reminds us of his baptism, of which St. Paul writes, "All who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death and resurrection." When Dick was baptized, he was clothed in a white garment, a sign that he was born into Christ. We now clothe his body with this white garment, a symbol and a sign that he is now reborn into eternal life. Let us pray. Almighty God and Father, it is our certain faith that your Son who died on the cross was raised from the dead, the first fruits of all who have fallen asleep. Grant it to this mystery your beloved servant Dick, who has gone to his rest in Christ, may share in the joy of his resurrection. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. We shall listen to God's word.
A reading from the book of Revelation. I, John, heard a voice from heaven say, "Write this, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from now on." "Yes," said the Spirit, "let them find rest from their labors, for their works accompany them." The word of the Lord.
Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, from death into life. God is my shepherd, so nothing I shall want. I rest in the meadows of faithfulness and love. I walk by the quiet
beyond my fears. reading from the second letter of St. Paul to Timothy. In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead? And in view of his appearing in his kingdom, I solemnly urge you, proclaim the message. As for me, I am already being poured out as a libation, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. The word of the Lord.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You have faith in God, have faith also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If there were not, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you also may be. Where I am going, you know the way." Thomas said to him, "Master, we do not know where you're going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord.
At this time in our liturgy, the invitation is to pause with some reflection and homily. Words of eulogy will be spoken later to remember the stories of Dick's life and the gifts and the anecdotes that make up the beauty and the wonder of a life fully lived. But for these few moments, our invitation is to speak in homily, which is to endeavor to discover what the meaning of this moment is to each and every one of us. Everything that happens in life, everything has a teaching. And this moment has a teaching where we cancel the world and the busy life and the many distractions, and we enter into a house of silence and we listen and we contact the meaning and the teaching of the moment. Sharon Bruce, the rabbi Sharon, in her recent best-selling book, The Amen Effect, speaks about the prayer of mourning, the Kaddish, which is Jewish prayer of mourning. And she says, it has impact and full meaning only when it happens in an assembly bonded in charity, in friendship, in faith, and in family. In this environment, she says, the Kaddish has real meaning. outside of that environment, it loses its impact. And such we have today. We have a community gathered in celebration and in gratitude, but especially in belonging. And therefore, our prayer of mourning has special meaning. So let me try to touch the margins of Dick's soul here, his Irish soul. David Brooks, in his wonderful book, you know, Road to Character, says, there are virtues in life, there are resume virtues, speak about your achievements and all of the wonderful things you conquered in life. He says these are important, but they're not very important. What is very important is eulogy virtues. Were you kind? Were you generous? Were you caring? Were you forgiving? Were you welcoming? Eulogy virtues are the only virtues that live on. They come alive in the flesh and the blood of a family, of a community, of a people. Eulogy virtues stay alive. They're enlarged, they're cultivated, and they're passed on to another generation. So at the end, in the end, it's the kindness and the caring and the generosity and the goodness, the integrity of a person's pledge, a person's word, a person's living faith. This is what has impact at the end of a life and the beginning of a new life in eternity. So let me pause over a few words of reflection on eulogy virtues. Now, people around Holy Family are familiar with the Greek word euangelion, which means good news. In Old English, it is gus spiel. It mutated into gospel. We read from the Gospel of John. There are four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. We read from John. But now, in this moment, we're reflecting on the fifth Gospel, which is a Gospel according to Dick Ward. And that's a real Gospel now. Here you have generosity, you have fidelity, you have sacrifice. You have forgiveness. You have hospitality. God appears to us in the gospel according to Dick Ward. So let me reach into his gospel and summon just one thought that will be meaningful from the gospel according to Dick Ward. Way back in the 16th century, in Germany, there lived the Durer family, a large Catholic family. And in the family, there were two brothers, Albrecht and Albert, and they were close. They were both aspiring artists. And this story is told about Albrecht and Albert Durer, the brothers. While they were aspiring artists, they were poor people, and they couldn't afford to go to Nuremberg to the School of Art. So the two brothers made a covenant. They would draw straws, and whoever won would go to the School of Nuremberg, and the other person would work in the mines to support him during his artistic studies. And when he finished, he would come back and he would work in the mines to send the second brother there. Well, Albrecht was the one who drew the long straw, and he got to go to Nuremberg to study art. And Albert went to work in the mines. And after some time studying art, he became very proficient and he began to have a good reputation. He was making some money, and now his time was to come home and to allow his brother, who worked in the mines, to go to the School of Art, and he himself would work to support Albert in the school. So he came back and they had a great celebration, and the story is told that in the great festive moment, he said, "Now, Albert, it's your turn now to go to Nuremberg to study art." But Albert sadly, in tears, said, "My hands have been ruined working in the mine. My fingers no longer function. I cannot go to study art. I'm so deformed and so worn out by now, the moment is lost." And Albrecht said, had him put his hands in a praying position, and he drew a sketch of the praying hands. And these are the praying hands that we are very familiar with in many of our images, the praying hands of Albrecht Dürer. And these hands represent sacrifice. They represent putting other people first. In our world, they represent showing up at your ball games when you were kids, being your coach. They represent being a public servant. They represent being faithful in a family, being generous, sacrificing yourself, putting other people first. The gospel, according to Dick Ward. So, my friends, when you see the image of the praying hands, take it to be an image of the life and times of Dick Ward. But what does this mean to us? What grace and what impact does it have in our life? Is it just a story and we listen to it and then we forget? Or will it make a difference? Will we forgive somebody? Will we be patient with somebody? Will we understand somebody? Will we heal any wounds in a family or in a community? What does it mean that we begin to understand the teaching of Dick Ward's gospel? Will you go forth from here today and reach out to somebody who is lonely? Lift up somebody's spirit. Encourage somebody who is down. Understand somebody. Will we go forth from here and listen? Just listen openly to somebody and allow the person to have an opinion or a position with which we don't agree? Do we have to correct? Do we have to judge? Or will the praying hands teach us to sacrifice, to let the other person win, not to demand, not to control, not to have the last word? Let the celebration of this life make a difference for each and every one of us. Amen. Now, in the fact that Dick Ward was 100% Irish, how Irish can you get? I've been asked to sing this Irish anthem. It's a prayer. It's a prayer for fathers. I like to sing it for my father, and you listen to it for your father, and in a special way for Dick today. And it's called The Old Man. The tears have all been shed now. We've said our last goodbye. His soul's been blessed is laid to rest, and I feel all alone. He was more than just my father, my teacher, my best friend, and he'll still be heard in the tunes we've shared when we play them on my own. And I never will forget him, for he made me what I am. Though he may be gone, memories linger on. I miss him, the old man. As a boy, he'd take me walking by mountain, field, and stream, and show me things not known to kings, secrets between him and me, like the colors of the pheasant as she rises in the morn. Ah, how to fish or make a wish beside the fairy tree. And I never will forget him, for he made me what I am. Though he may be gone, memories linger on. I miss him, the old man. I thought he'd live forever. He looked so big and strong. But the minutes fly and the years roll by for a father and a son. And suddenly, when it happened, there was so much left unsaid. No second chance for words of thanks for all the things he'd done. And I never will forget him, for he made me what I am. Though he may be gone, memories linger on. I miss him, the old man. God, I miss him, the old man. Amen. Dick. Please stand. We now gather in prayer. My friends, Jesus Christ is risen from the dead, sits at the right hand of the Father, and there he intercedes for us, confident that God hears the prayers gathered here. We now offer these our petitions.
Please respond with, "Hear our prayer." In baptism, Richard received the light of Christ. Scatter the darkness now and lead him over the waters of death. Lord, in your mercy.
Our brother Richard, who lived a life of generosity and dedication to God and his family, that may be welcomed with love and joy into the heavenly home of the eternal Father. Lord, in your mercy.
For Richard's family, that they may be given hope, peace, and consolation, treasuring the memories they have of him. Lord, in your mercy.
For all those family members, caregivers, and friends who tirelessly offered support and care for Richard, that they may be rewarded with peace and consolation for their service. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For peace on earth and a world where our shared human experiences grow us into more caring and compassionate people. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For all gathered here to worship in faith, that the bonds which unite us may be strengthened as we look forward in hope to being united one day in the kingdom of heaven. Lord, in your mercy.
In the power of God's Spirit, we make these prayers. In the name of Jesus, O Lord, amen. Please be seated.
I invite all to join in singing number 440, You Are Near, number 440.
Pray that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. God of infinite love, bind us together in a community of forgiveness, understanding, a community of living faith. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord, in him the hope of a blessed resurrection has dawned. The sadness of death gives way to the bright promise of immortality. Lord, for your faithful people, life is changed, not ended. And when our earthly dwelling lies in death, we gain an everlasting dwelling place in heaven. And so, with all the choirs of angels, we sing our unending hymn of praise.
Holy, holy, God of God's grace.
kneel or be seated. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Let your Spirit come upon these gifts like the dewfall, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Before he was given up to death, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the cup and once again gave you thanks and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant. It will be shed for you and for all, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate this memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the cup of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and to minister to you. Humbly we pray that, sharing of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Jose, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember your servant Richard, whom you have called from this world unto yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in the resurrection. Remember also all of our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all those who've died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, that we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ.
Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Come together as one community of faith and pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, from every evil, and grant us peace in our day. In your mercy, keep us free from sin, and protect us from all distress, as we wait in joyful hope for the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "I leave you peace. My peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom, where you live forever and ever." Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Bless one another with a sign of Christ. few moments, we will have our sharing in the Eucharist. And since we have the blessing of many visitors, I'd like to pause for one moment and mention a revered practice which we have at all our Masses for many years here at Holy Family. Whereas we have many persons who come to pray with us, but they choose not to receive the Eucharist. It's not part of their prayer, not part of their religious belief or practice, and yet they enrich us with the gift of their presence. They choose not to receive the Eucharist. I don't tell people who is and is not worthy. I just know I'm not worthy, that's all. I make no judgments about anyone. But we're blessed to have those who pray with us who choose not to receive the Eucharist. If you wish to come with the communicants and cross yourself in this manner, we will gladly extend to you the welcoming blessing of the Church. In the house of the Lord, there are no stepchildren. We are all God's people, the Hindu, the Muslim, the Hebrew, the agnostic, Buddhist, whoever you are, you belong to the community of God's people. And so if you're praying with us today and you choose not to receive the Eucharist, if you wish to come with the communicants and if you will cross yourself in this manner, we'll gladly extend to you the welcoming and respectful blessing of the Church. My friends, this is Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. And happy are we called to the supper of the Lamb.
I invite all to join in singing number 439, Be Not Afraid, number 439.
Thank you.
Prayer continues with number 616, I Have Loved You, 616. Continues with number 360, Panda Vida, number 360.
Thank you. Hello, friends. I'm Peter. I'm Dick's son, for those of you I haven't had the chance to meet yet or haven't seen for a while. I'd like to thank Monsignor for saying such kind words about my father and the beautiful song. A pillar of the community is someone who is well recognized and plays an important and active role in supporting their community. I think this phrase describes Dick Ward well. I was acutely reminded of this when the paramedics and firefighters who came to his rescue when he had a stroke all recognized him and thanked him for his service to the community of San Marino. My dad became a pillar of the community a long time ago. He started coaching girls softball. He loved coaching Beth, Katie, and Megan. He took great pride in how his Seagulls performed. After his success with the girls, he moved on to Little League, where he coached many of my teams, most of which were fairly successful. The exception being my Astros team in fifth grade, which was the San Marino version of the Bad News Bears. Not to say that he was Walter Matthau that was drinking beer during practice, but some people did say that he kind of looked like Walter Matthau. He coached many of Tommy's baseball teams and eventually became the Little League president. One of my favorite childhood moments, and one of the moments that I was most proud of him as a kid, was when he hosted the Little League draft in our house. Tommy and I loved watching him basking in all the camaraderie among the coaches. Outside of sports, he engaged in many civic functions. He held leadership positions in the Pasadena Rotary Club, the San Marino City Club, the San Marino Schools Foundation, and the Pasadena Respiratory Health Foundation. This probably goes without saying, but my dad was a really social guy. Although Parkinson's disease took away his ability to stride independently, it could not keep him from attending all of his beloved social clubs, including the 20th Century Roundtable, the Rotary Club, Joie de Vivre, the Friendly Sons of St. Patrick, and the Knights of the Holy Sepulchre. Of course, he did this with the help of his soulmate, Anne, and his incredible team of caregivers, including Jonathan, Lila, Ronnie, Josie, and May. He was a reluctant politician. Prior to becoming a politician, he bought a silver Lincoln town car with plush baby blue interior upholstery. Our family dubbed it the Mayor Mobile and always joked that my dad should become mayor, never thinking that he would ever want to. It must have sunk in because eventually he decided to run for the San Marino City Council to finish the job that his brother-in-law, Bud Salvatti, had initially set out to do. He didn't go into politics for power or money. He went into politics because he felt it was the right thing to do for his community. He met many good friends on the city council and many of the people who make San Marino run. He loved serving his community. Even when he had to negotiate a settlement to the infamous Poopgate incident. Aside from his civic duties, he was many other things. When I was a kid, he was an intimidating force. When my siblings or I screwed something up, he would let us know with a "you doof" and a firm pat on the noggin. In the 80s, he was a staunch Reagan Republican who became much more open-minded and compassionate in his older years. He was skillful in both making and drinking wine. He was a sportsman and a sports fan, a lover of Notre Dame football, college basketball, and the Los Angeles Dodgers. And of course, he was a family man. He was the son of Catherine and Richard, and the older brother to Tom, Joyce, Phil, and Marilyn. After his father passed away, he was the patriarch of his family. He was known as Da to his grandchildren, which is Irish for grandfather. He cherished every opportunity that we could all be together in the same place with him. He was a good friend to all of us. Last but not least, he was the man who patented the first Frisbee in 1967. Patent number 3,359,678. For this, he will always have a unique and ironic relationship with hippies all over the world.
I'm Katie, the second daughter. I picked out some characteristics of my dad. I guess you could say I learned from the Gospel of Dick Ward. My dad was very social, but he used socialization to connect with the world around him. Rather than to climb a social ladder. My dad was curious and intelligent, and he used these traits to travel and learn about different people and cultures. Over time, I saw him evolve into a more empathetic person. My dad was a discerning person, and because of this, he provided counsel to myself and four other people, my brothers and sisters, Peter, Tommy, Beth, and Megan. I consider four of the greatest people and friends. My dad was considered a classic. As he grew into his geriatric years, he taught me a lot about those years and how they can absolutely be the best years of a lifespan. Instead of focusing on the things he had lost, he only saw what he gained.
Though Dick Ward shared his light on the world through his many roles, husband, father, brother, uncle, community leader, attorney, and teacher, I'd like to share some thoughts on and images of Dick Ward as a coach that has had a lasting impact on me and my brothers and sisters, and most likely the teammates of all those he coached. With a booming voice and an executive presence, Dick Ward could inspire many emotions on his team of 8 to 10-year-olds. One of his most influential posts as a coach was as a first base coach in softball or baseball for the Seagulls, Katie, Beth, and Megan's softball team, or for the Cardinals, Senators, Colts, Pirates, or the infamous Astros as Peter and my Little League teams. When you were up at the plate as a batter in the batter's box and you made contact, as long as the ball was put into play, even if it was the weakest of contact, that would surely result in an easy out. You started your obligatory, uninspired jog towards first base. You would inevitably look up towards first base and see a crouching Dick Ward in tight 1980s coach's pants and striped socks to the shin, imploring you down the first base line with the belief in his signature booming voice that you could make it to first base safely by saying his mantra, dig, 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 dig. While the mantra and experience itself rarely resulted in anything other than an out at first base, the image of Dick Ward, the words, the expression on his face, and the 1980s coach's pants stay with myself, my brothers and sisters, and no doubt with those he coached. Among a lifetime of lessons and inspiration, I offer this one today. Whenever I find myself in a hopeless situation, feeling sorry for myself, the image of Dick Ward in 1980s coach's pants appears in my mind, imploring me never to give up with the words, dig, dig, dig.
My name's Megan. I'm the third daughter. My son Ronaldo and I interviewed my dad during 2020 for a pandemic project. And we asked my dad, when you look back on your life, what are the values that guide you? He said the three values that guided him were integrity, honesty, and compatibility. The value of integrity guided him during his working life. It helped him give impartial advice, he said, to his clients and not shade the good or the bad. He said honesty guided him as he always tried to be fair and honest whenever he was with other people. And compatibility. He said that he always tried to be pleasant and understanding of the people he was dealing with. I feel grateful for my dad being such an example of how to live. Work hard, be adventurous, and take care of your friends and family. My dad said families are the most important because they are the closest people you will ever have in your life, and they deserve the support and cooperation. I will miss my dad, and I will hold on to these values in my heart and remember him always.
Hi, I'm Beth Ward Francisconi, and I want to thank Monsignor Connolly for letting all of us speak, and I want to thank Father O'Neill as well. My dad, he experienced a historical milestone this year. One of his most cherished creations turned 50. No, it wasn't the birth of his middle child, and it wasn't this the celebrated arrival of his firstborn son. It was the product of three Jesuit-educated St. Louis Billiken STEM college roommates. Half a century ago, my dad's passion project was born. 1974 was the year Dick Ward, Bill Ellinger, and John Sasson started making wine under the La Vista label. I share this fact among the list of things my father accomplished: an electrical engineer, a patent attorney, a father, a coach, a community leader, and an adoring grandfather. Because I think being an amateur vintor truly captures the essence of who he was. You see, my dad was one of the most social people I have ever met. He exhibited FOMO, fear of missing out, before the concept was ever coined. Growing up, he and my mother went out every Saturday night. I remember my sisters and I begging them to stay home, but not Dick Ward. He wanted to show off his wife, Anne, and he wanted to be in the thick of action every weekend. He committed to going out on Saturday nights as much as he committed to going to church on Sunday mornings. I remember in college at Notre Dame, all my roommates and our parents went out to eat. Post-dinner, the parents were to drop all the girls off at Bridget's Bar and then head back to their hotel rooms. Not Dad. He begged me to take him with us to the bar, and we did under one condition: he would pay the bill. My siblings can share multiple stories of my father as a social animal. He spent nights in Italy drinking wine with Megan and Hans. And there are stories of Dad and Tommy climbing into a hostel window in Ireland after a night at an Irish pub. There were family gatherings in Marion, Massachusetts, with Peter hosting our crew of 25. But it didn't have to be an organized event. Many nights for decades were spent with Katie, drinking her latest delivery from Gary Vaynerchuk's Wine Library TV Club. My dad couldn't wait for COVID to end, and the thought of attending the wedding of his youngest brother's son was one of the key events that got him through the pandemic, giving him the will to make it to New Hampshire so he could dance and celebrate with all of his living siblings, their spouses, and their children's children. Bottom line, he never wanted to miss out on a celebratory event. But back to his beloved grape juice. I think his love of wine came not from the finished product, which did win multiple awards over the years, but from the socialization and the camaraderie making the wine entailed. There were Labor Day weekend trips to Napa, where he and his friends and their friends camped and picked the grapes. There were monthly trips to Laguna Beach to squeeze, ferment, rack, and bottle the wine. And there were gatherings with the roommates, his joie de vivre wine club comrades, friends, family, and really anyone who enjoyed a glass of vino and conversation. My dad leaves behind quite a legacy, but his hobby of amateur winemaking serves as a fitting illustration of how he loved to be with people, to create and celebrate, and never miss a party. Cheers, Dad. I hope you're enjoying the fruits of your labor and a glass of your latest La Vista vintage.
Please stand. And now, my friends, before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our beloved brother Dick. May our farewell express our affection for him, may it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again, when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself.
May the road rise up to meet you. May the wind be always with you. May the sun shine warm you always.
Into your hands, Father of mercies, we now commend our brother Dick in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he has risen now to new life. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon him in this life, signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother forever. Dick, may the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you and take you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. May the choirs of angels welcome you and lead you to the bosom of Abraham, and where Lazarus the beggar is poor no longer, may you find eternal rest. Amen. Amen. We shall now go in peace to love and to serve the Lord and one another.
And I invite everyone to join in singing number 450, Amazing Grace, 450.